You guys have a good weekend so far?
Pretty good.
Yesterday was beautiful, wasn't it? Really nice. I kept looking for excuses to go outside. Just so nice, so clear, beautiful weather. And everybody seemed to be out, moving around. There were a lot of folks going in and out of the library. A lot of folks seemed to be milling around downtown. Very nice weekend. In my world, these weekends are far and few between where I can just kind of quiet and watch things happen. As most of you know, I'm married to a teacher. And so this time of the year, things get a little crazy. We're closing up grades. Lisa runs the student government for the junior high. We're getting ready to do teacher evaluations. And this year, it's even crazier because my daughter's going to graduate and we have prom next week. So to just have a little free time is kind of nice. And I kind of needed actually yesterday to recover because Friday night, I had to do something that I have to do four times a year, actually. I am a permanent chaperone at all the West Lafayette Junior High dances. Yeah, I have to go to all these dances, and I've been doing this since 2001, and I kind of got it down. You know, that's my part-time job. I know what I'm supposed to do, and we have one Friday night, and this is the spring dance. And every one of these dances, they have one every quarter. Each has its own particular feel. And I don't mean just like seasonal. I mean, you can literally, if you show up, you can watch the kids grow up before your eyes. It's like time-lapse photography. You'll see these kids when they first come in, they're seventh graders, and they have that many social skills. They have no idea what to do with a dance. And by this time, I mean, they're already going to high school. They're freshmen. And hey, I'm a man of the world. I'm a woman of the world. Don't talk to me, old man. Get out of my way. That's kind of their attitude. So it's kind of fun to be there. My particular job, by the way, at these dances, the way the building is set up is the dance is usually in one room. This year it was in the junior high gym. And then West Lafayette being what? They also have a high school gym. So they open up the high school gym as well. And the idea is if you don't want to dance, then you can go run around the gym. And my job is to be in the run around gym and just to stand there and look menacing at kids and make sure they don't try to do full court basketball shots, because every time somebody does, somebody gets hit in the back of the head. And to be real honest, this spring dance, I really didn't have much of a job because they're all growing up. They're all growing up. Now, if you go to a fall dance, it's completely different. The girls are all in one room, and the guys are all in another. The girls want to dance. The girls are ready. I mean, they're togged out, maybe not very well, but they're trying really hard, you know. They're trying really hard to look grown up and sophisticated, and the guys are squirrels, okay? The guys don't know what a girl is, and what they do know is that you're scared of them, and so let's go play basketball real quick. And they run around in the gym and they do crazy things. And then the girls kind of come in and stand and watch them. And that makes the guys act even squirrelier because they think that if I do really goofy things, this will attract the female. And girls really does give women another reason to look down at men. But that's kind of what generally happens. By this time of the year, it's all changed. And now there's only a couple of diehard guys and a couple of diehard girls that want to play basketball. And everybody else is off in the gym. And it makes me sad. It makes me sad that my babies, they're growing up. They're growing up. They're right in front of my eyes. They're growing up. And there's part of me that wants to go back into the dance hall and say, come back to the gym. Come back. Play basketball. Look, I'll get a volleyball out for you, too. Come back. But can't do that. You gotta let them go. You gotta let them go, you gotta let them move on. Raymond Chandler once said that to say goodbye is to die a little bit. And that's kind of what I felt like on Friday night. Well, these aren't even my kids for crying out loud. And I'm mourning for them because I'm watching them go off to do great things. And I'm watching my daughter get ready to do the same thing. And I don't think I'm alone in having this kind of feeling. Is this something that you felt as well? We understand with our heads that life has changed, that we can't keep things the way they are, that they have to move on. But our hearts hurt. It's really difficult. I don't think this, by the way, is just your experience or mine. I also think this is the experience that we hear conveyed to us through Scripture. If you listen really closely to that reading from Revelation, behold, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the former things have passed away. And in Revelation's day, what they were talking about, the former things, was the old world, the way things worked. In the old world, it was really simple. We could count upon the Roman legal system, and we could count on the Roman Empire to protect us from persecution. The first wave of persecution that the church ever faced was not from the Romans. It was from the Jewish communities. And it was the Romans that would step in and kind of a good cop role and say, no, we can't do that. We can't have riots, okay? We've got to stop that. No, we can't just go stoning people. We have courts. You just can't be following people around and making their lives miserable, kind of like Paul experienced on these missionary journeys. No, there has to be law and order. But that changes in the generation that is experiencing life under Rome in Revelation. Now, as I've told you before, the Roman Empire is not our friend. Now, Roman Homeland Security has been unleashed, and it is running the church into a gopher hole. And you can hear almost, can't you, some people who remember that old world saying, I miss that old world. It was safe and predictable, and I understood it, and I don't like this. You can hear them saying goodbye to that old world and grieving, just like we grieve too. Just grieving as we go through life. Can I tell you something? That is absolutely normal. To quote the Princess Bride, life is pain, and anyone who tells you differently is trying to sell you something. It really is. To grow up is to hurt a little bit. To love something more than yourself is to experience a wee bit of grief. There's just no way to get around it. Let me illustrate it this way. Every story, Book of Revelation, what I'm experiencing when I sit in the gym and I watch these dances, what you're experiencing is you move from one phase of your life to the next. And by the way, Wabash Christian's story, as we figure out where we are going now, always begins with an end. That's an omega, by the way. The last of the Greek alphabet. It always begins with an end. I mean, seriously, can you think of a book? Can you think of a movie? Can you think of a play that you've gone to where it just starts out and they all live happily ever after? No. It starts out with a wicked stepmother, or it starts out with a ring of power. It starts out with some problem that needs to be resolved. It always starts, not with a beginning, but it starts with an end. So as your children grow, what makes you hurt are the ends, right? As your marriage matures, or as your body matures, or as you go through the various rungs on the career ladder, what hurts as we can't do what we used to do, as we have to turn to what we now must do, are the ends. And can I be real personal for a second? Okay, I'm going to stray over the line here between preaching and meddling a little bit. What hurts Wabash Christian right now, and will continue to hurt for some time, is just a natural series of ends. Some things that we are outgrowing, some things that are worn and patched, and that we don't need anymore. Some things God is saying, I know you love that, but I have better for you. So let go of that. One of those ends I ran into this past week in the session of OSS that we did on female clergy. If you were there, you know what we talked about. We talked about how disciples have historically kind of been standard bearers when it comes to women in leadership roles of ministry. Our first ordained female minister took place in 1891, and to this very day, We are the only mainline Protestant denomination that has a female CEO. Her name is Shannon Watkins. And we were discussing this, and it was real interesting to hear people's responses to the simple fact that today, in 2016, 55% of all seminarians are female. I was also interested to hear from some of you that this isn't the only professional pathway that it's seeing this. Dentistry is going this way. Law school is going this way. Med school is going this way. Females now are more represented in undergraduate college programs than males. Females have demonstrated conclusively there is nothing that a man can do that they cannot do, and there is one thing they can certainly do that a man cannot do, and that is that tutor. If any of you men know different about that, please let me know. But I know that, as far as I know, no man has been able to accomplish that. Now, this is just a fact. This is not theology. This is just a fact. If we take that fact and we apply it here, it just simply says that we have a better than even chance of having a female standing here than a male. Personally, I think God is at work in this. I think God is telling us that we need to outgrow some of our expectations of ministry. God is saying there are capable females and capable males, and by the way, there are incapable males and incapable females. And when you go to search, when you go to look for the new order of things, one of the things that needs to pass away from the old order of things is your expectation for what your leader should look like. And I apologize if I'm going for preaching the meddling here. I'm going to meet me out back by the dumpster later on. I fully understand. This is not my agenda. I'm just simply sharing with you what I see happening, not just here, but throughout ministry, really throughout society. You will have a better than average chance of having a female leader than you will a male. And that really shouldn't surprise us too much because, am I wrong? We've always had outstanding female leaders. We've just always been on the lay leader side. Now we're beginning to see them on the ordained side as well. So, for the old order of things to pass away for us, we need to set aside that assumption that our leaders have to be male. Can be female as well. But we will never see that, you see. We will never step into that new possibility if we do not accept it first, the death of the old expectation. Am I making sense here? Am I making sense? Here's maybe another one, okay? If you want to slash my tires, let me know, because I'll go move my car. But here's another expectation that in this particular time is coming to an end that needs to be passing away. Yeah, I'm not trying to pick a fight. I like Wabash. I really do. It's a great place. Seriously. I love to go downtown, look in the junk store. I haven't met anybody here I don't like. It's difficult or problematic or anything. It's a great town. If I was going to start my family now with little kids, this would be a great place to grow up. I worry a little bit with the Little League because I hear pretty fierce in there. Some of those coaches are kind of crazy. But other than that, it's a pretty good place. That being said, this is not the same Wabash of 1968. Right? Can we say that? We could say also the same thing about Marion or Pendleton or Muncie or Kokomo. We are in the middle of a major cultural, socioeconomic change here. Now, the reason I point this out is this congregation has a long history of calling pastors to this place because we think of ourselves as the crown jewel in the crown of Christendom. When we speak about Wabash, we love it, but then we stray and we begin to talk about this place like it's Rome and only the Pope is fit to come here. I love it here. It's a great place. But part of what also needs to maybe come to an end, part of where we are being shaped by God to help us see a new possibility, is recognize that Reverend Carpenter wouldn't come here today as it is. Nor would most of those fine looking gentleman, my kids call it tombstones out in the hallway. They would. This is not to say that Wabash is bad or backwards. It's just to say it is what it is. And if you lay it down next to a major urban area or a place with a big university or a big cultural drawing card, and Huntsville Center is nice, but it's not Broadway. But we need to maybe, again, adapt our expectations. We maybe need to realize that God is bringing to an end a set of assumptions that we have not only about our pastor who should be here, but that we have about ourselves. This is a good place, and this is a place populated by good people. But we also need to be realistic about it. The old order of things is passing away. That's all I'm talking about. We need to be realistic. We need to be realistic by saying that right now God, to a large extent, is coming and is moving us from one paradigm to the next. Again, I apologize if I stepped on any toes. I'll be hiding right behind Jay Whitmer. You can come after me later. Okay, I'll be good. The text goes on. It says, "And then I saw the new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven, fit like a bride for her husband." Most of us read that today and think that's kind of high-flown, poetical language. What does that have to do with anything? What does it have to do with me? Can I be honest with you? When that text was first written, it wasn't meant to be read as poetry. It was supposed to be read like you read a city map. When the writers of Revelation were talking about the New Jerusalem, they had in mind Jerusalem, the city that was the capital, first under David, and then continues to be the cultural site for all of Judaism. They had a specific place in mind. They were saying, part of the world is coming to an end, and part of the world is beginning. And we can begin to see the outlines of that new world now. And it will look, in some ways, a lot like the world we already know, but it will also be new. It'll be like a bride, just coming in for the first time. You get your first glance at her. She's not to the altar yet. She's still back there at the door. Everybody's just stood up and turned around, and everybody's just kind of done that, oh my, look at her, kind of feeling. Where is this going? Maybe before we start thinking about our next minister, we ought to be thinking about our ministry. Not as it is now, but as it will be. The key to finding the right person, ultimately, to stand up here or sit in my office or do the things that I'm supposed to be doing, is not to look at our expectations, but to actually look at our community as it is. That is our Jerusalem. We ought to be looking at Wabash County in the same way that the writer of Revelation looked at Jerusalem. Where is God now in Wabash County? And by the way, at Warsaw as well. I figure God gets over to Kosciuszko School every once in a while. I think he goes there for the donuts. I do. Where is God moving in Wabash County? Specifically, where is God moving in the lives of the people who aren't here right now? Did you know, according to U.S. surveys, that 90% of Americans believe in God? That's remarkable. 90% of our neighbors have no problem believing in a higher power. And if you think about it, you can see why. They don't believe in the government's ability to save them. They don't believe in the economy. They don't believe in education. A lot of times they don't even believe in their own ability to improve the quality of their own life. They have no problem having faith in something other than themselves. This is a remarkable shift. When I first started ministry, the statistic hung around 50%. 50% of people had no problem believing in God. In the last 50 years, our potentiality for faith has grown and grown and grown. I mean, seriously, listen to all the God talk out there. When Donald Trump talks about God, that tells you something about the times that we're living in. When any candidate can feels compelled to talk about their spirituality so they can appeal for the support of Americans. That tells you about the lay of the land. When Oprah talks about God, no. The problem in this time isn't people don't believe in God. The problem is people don't believe in the church. They see the church as just one more institution that wants to put their hands in their pocket and gets its claws into their head and control their lives. And they don't want anything to do with that. We are surrounded, my friends, by people like that. What we have to do is leave the building and go to them. God is at work there. That is our New Jerusalem. What we need to do is go and prove to them that we are not so much focused on the past, but that we are focused on the future. Does that make sense to you? That means we have to stop worrying about things like how people come to church dressed, or what they look like, or how they vote. That means we have to focus more on what God has already done in their lives and catching up with it. Can I be honest? Those people many times can tell us more about God than we can tell them. That is our New Jerusalem. That is the future. Am I the only one who feels maybe that's what's going on? But that is where God is calling us. I'll take a little bit of weight off you. We're not the only church that faces this. Any congregation over 20 years old is currently facing this challenge. To do what a friend of mine calls the Elvis gospel. Elvis has left the building. Well, the church needs to do the same thing. What's that old song we sang in the 70s? They will know we are Christians by our love. Now it's not just a song. Now it's what we live and we die by. Old order of things had passed away. And I saw the New Jerusalem. And then what's in between? Which is really where we are right now. William Bridges, who is the guy who kind of came up with this way of displaying how transition occurred, said, "This is where most of us live, and it's the most uncomfortable place, because just like the folks in Revelation, we're not quite here, we're not quite here, we're in transition, we're in between, and we're waiting." And you know what transition is, right? It's a time of waiting and worrying, and it's a great deal of anxiety. The anxiety makes some of us want to go back to this. We just need to go back to what we know. We need to go back to the good old days. Read the Bible, you see the same thing. There were people on the way to the promised land that were saying, "No, it's not too late. We need to go back to Egypt." And Moses is going, "Are we lost in cotton picking mine? We were slaves. You want to go back to being slaves? Well, at least we know what buttons to push and we know what levers to pull. We had a feeling of security in there." I have no doubt there are some folks like that here. There are others who just want to go tearing off into this. Let's be the future now. I have exactly the plan to do that, they will say. We need to do A, B, and C. 1, 2, and 3. Let's get going. And they lose very quickly any patience or any grace that they have with anyone who's not absolutely convinced that they have seen the future. I have no doubt that those people are here as well. But the real work of faith is here. It is trusting that God will get us from here to here. I can tell you some of the things that we're going to be doing here. We are going to be looking at our community very closely. We're going to be wading up to our eyeballs into the demographics and trying to understand what is Wabash like in 2016 and where it's going. We'll do that. We're going to work really hard to prepare our search committee so that when they do the work, they have more than just a set of standard answers that are handed out with every searching call packet. So they can ask, seriously, what is it that you can do as our next leader to get us from here to here? We'll do that. But here's the deal. Here's the real deal. Revelation lays its finger right on it. And then I heard the one who was seated upon the throne say, "Behold, I make all things new." yeah, there are things that we need to do, but the most important thing we need to do is we need to place our trust on the one who is in the throne. We need to, in our interaction one with one another and with God, be continually reminding one another, God is you. There is no movement at all, much less movement from here to here, unless God makes it so. We need to remind ourselves of that, because I don't think our disappointments and our frustrations are gone. They never are completely. But we need to speak to one another, remind one another, He is making us new. Yeah, you didn't get what you wanted. I didn't get what I wanted. But God got what God wanted. Maybe that was the point all along. We need to remind each other of that when we have successes. Because we don't want to get cocky. We want to say to one another, that was really good. And you know what? That was a sign that God is here and God is making us new. We need to witness to one another that there is more at work here than us. There always has been. It is the Alpha. It is the Omega. It is the one who says, write this down. This is trustworthy. Or in the words of the psalmist, yes, sing your praises, but sing them to me. Because I am your God. That seems to me is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. That seems to me is the end of this lesson. Let's say we pray.